Hi, y'all. It's Crystal from All Bodies Welcome Electrolysis here in San Jose, California. So excited to be introducing and interviewing today Kelly from Electrolysis by Kelly in the Chicago area. I know you're in Illinois.
Yeah, I'm in Oak Park, which is 10 miles west of the Loop in Chicago.
It's a nice area, Oak Park. Really nice. So I've been doing electrolysis for a year, sort of, because I opened October 15th and then I had to shut down for the pandemic March 15th. So officially open and legal for 6 months and then closed for the pandemic for 6 months. So I'm really new to this. Kelly, on the other hand, has been doing this since 1986 and is a font of information and tips and tricks and love chatting with you. I like chatting with everybody in our industry because I love learning more. I like to learn. So thanks for doing this today.
Oh, you're so welcome. You're welcome.
And I know that's your very cool office. I remember seeing it before. You said a very eclectic, fun office in there. All kinds of fun stuff, mermaids and all kinds of cool, neat stuff, neat art.
Yeah, the
So,
different offices that I have, I've got like four main rooms. I mean, actually, I think I got like six electrologists now, including me in the office here. And each room kind of has a little bit different style. And my room's the water room. So we kind of got a desert room and like
all the elements.
yeah, well, not really that, but we've kind of got a room that's got a drawing on the wall that was done in 2001, and there's like little cats hidden in there because this used to be a dental office, and
Oh.
so they used to entertain the kids by going, "Oh, find the cats," and the kids would be like,
Oh.
"Oh,
That's
you know,
smart. That's really
cat,"
smart.
you know.
How long have you guys been back to work?
I went back to work the first or the last Saturday in May because we were allowed to open on the last Friday in May. A couple of my staff went back that next Monday, which was June 1st. Another one of my staff members came back at the latter part of June because their children were in school. So she only really worked like Fridays and Saturdays until our kids were out of school, and then she went back to her regular schedule. And then I had two electrologists that wanted to wait till July 1st. So I was like, tell me what you're comfortable with, do what you want to do, just let me know so I know who I can book where.
How's business? Are you getting busy again?
We were pretty busy. We're kind of like almost as busy as we really want to be. One of the things that I learned about COVID is one of the things I did is I actually gave myself a raise in January, and then I was kind of reevaluating things, and I gave myself another raise when I came back from COVID, because it's just I'm worth it, you know. And what I'm looking towards in the future is being able to teach more. So, as my staff, which are all in different levels of practice, you know, my newer ones, when they just graduate, they start at 60 an hour. And as they develop, you know, I raise them increments of $10 an hour. So I have people all the way from 60. I've got some at 90, some at like 80, some at 100, some at 110. You know, I'm 160 an hour.
Good for you.
So we're all priced differently due to our whatever. And what I learned is I can actually do about 4 hours of treatment a day, make enough what I want to do to be able to pay myself and have the other ones be as busy as they want. So I have more time to teach.
Good, yeah.
That's what I want to move into is half the time I took a day off. I'm working 5 days a week now.
That crazy? I know, right before the
Yeah,
pandemic.
like
I was working like seven
unbelievable.
days a week right before the pandemic, mostly because I wanted to take a little vacation. So I was like, busy, busy, busy. And there's only 1,400 electrologists in all of California, so we all stay really busy here. And so I took, we took the pandemic break, and we were able to go back to work about 2 weeks ago. And the first week was kind of in, but now like today I got three new clients via text message, and I created this whole email template that said, my time is more valuable than ever. And I'm asking for a $30 deposit up front because if people cancel, I'm keeping that $30. I don't have time. People are begging me to come in now because everybody's hairy from the pandemic, right? And yeah, my time is valuable, and I'm not going to play that game like I was playing before, which is like, please, can you get me in? Please, can you get in? Nope. I need a half an hour between clients to sanitize. I'm not going to rush myself. Like, there's so much business here that doesn't need to, I don't need to behave that way. I need to think about longevity, right? Because you've been doing this for a lot of years. I want to be able to do it for a lot of years too.
Yeah. And it's kind of stuff that I wish I had thought about when I was a new electrologist. Because when I was new, I had worked for an electrologist sweatshop, basically. And we had clients every half hour on the hour, right on the hour, people in and out. And there was no room for really relaxing. And then, you know, maybe after about, you know, 20 years of working like that, I suddenly realized, hey, I'm in control of my own schedule. I can put time in between people. Ding, light bulb went on, you know. And so I started, you know, giving myself more breaks, you know. Now, you know, we put time in between people. So we've got time to, if we need a few minutes to ourselves. I used to smoke, and I used to use smoking as an excuse to take a couple of minutes. What I learned to do is, instead of saying, oh, I need a cigarette, it's like, I just need a couple minutes, you know.
Wow. Yeah.
Self-permission to do that, because sometimes you just need a couple minutes to regroup and focus.
And to stretch and to get your blood moving again and stuff. Because, yeah, before we started the record button, I was asking you, what kinds of things do you do? Like, you stretch in between clients? How do you, your back starts to get a little achy, you know? I have to get my, you know, stamina up again, because it's been 6 months without working. So all of a sudden, here I am again, you know, doing, you know, three appointments. And I'm like, oh, no, my back is stiff because I'm not being smart about this, you know. So what do you do after a client? How do you just, like, get out of your client and get ready for the next one?
Well, sometimes I just shake it off, just like what you did, you know. I do a lot of this, you know, stretching my hands like that, like this. I'm always doing my neck, doing this kind of stuff. I do a lot of, maybe get over here, you know, stretching my shoulders back, because we're usually hunched over like this. Also, a lot of times when I'm working, every once in a while, I assess myself. And sometimes you just get in those things and you're like this, and you have to go, you know, get your position. So I've been, especially since I've been teaching, I teach it, so now I have to, you know, practice what I preach.
Yeah.
Myself all the time, going, okay, I need to drop my shoulder down.
I was, when I was going to school at Randa's school, the Monterey Bay Institute, one of the things she was big on too was, like, when you're getting into like a spot and the things aren't going well, she's like, stop, move away from the client, take a breath, think about the basics. Now just keep your pose the way, use your hands the way you're supposed to, and because sometimes when you're fighting something, it's really you are causing the fight, right? When you're fighting with an insertion, you're fighting with a setting, it's probably you. You probably just need to take a step back and regroup and think it out again.
Yeah, I mean, you know, whether you're doing, if you went to Randa, you probably learned two-handed. And with our students right now, we're trying to teach them both, you know, because sometimes it's really convenient doing one hand. Sometimes it's really convenient doing two-hand. You know, and sometimes I do a version between a one and a two hand. You know, I may hold the tweezers like I do on the one hand with one hand and do the regular insertions as you normally would with two handed, just depending on how much room I have and what angle that I'm doing. So, you know, you can mix it up.
You can. And actually, that's an interesting point that you bring up, because I have a client whose legs I'm working on, and she's really, like, she jumps every time. And she's really, like, jumpy, like she's had a bunch of caffeine. And so I have started gripping her leg under my body, and we get her foot crooked around here. And by the way, I know this person for like 15 years too. And then in that case, I'm doing one-handed, because I can't do two hands. So I'm just doing a bunch of hairs on her leg, and then, you know, remove them. And she's so cute. She's like, you could fit her in my pocket. She's so tiny. But when she jumps, it's like, oh my God. So I have to get her whole arm to get in there.
Yeah, I mean, everybody's got a different touch. I definitely have a firm grip. You know, people say they feel like they're very secure in my hands. And with some clients, I have to, like, lighten my touch, because you know I got you, you know. But that's what makes it good. Everybody will find, you know, the people I work with, because we all have it's like haircuts. We all have different touches and ways about doing things. So
what's like, what's your dream client? Like, where do you love to work? Like, what part of the body do you just love, love, love?
Oh, number one, I like people that can tolerate what I want to do. Skin that can tolerate it. Nice hydrated skin, nice pliable skin.
Right.
Big juicy freaking hairs I can just throw from my shoulder and be like, you know, the that music goes through my head when I'm really going on a roll, you know. But I just like a big old honking face full of big chunky hairs that but have this gooiness going right over my shoulder. I really love those thick hairs.
Yeah, it's really exciting to me too, especially like when I help my PCOS clients, you know, and you know they walk in and they have hair, you know, from here to here, and I'm like, I can't wait, you know, and I first of all, I know how great they're gonna feel when it's gone,
mm-hmm.
you know, it's so I just can't wait to just like you said, it's juicy. Like this one lady asked me, "Are you having a climax?" I'm like, I know, but man, this is so fun. Like, it's so satisfying. I love my work. I miss my clients so much for those 6 months. It's so rewarding. And it's like being a part of a trans person's hair removal too. I feel such a privilege. I feel so honored. And I feel honored to help people with PCOS. And I'm happy to be a part of their journey. And I hope I can help them to have less. It's hard if you are a femme presenting person and you have facial hair, like, you know, that's very masculine looking, and I just my heart is hurts for them. I want to help as much as I can.
Yeah, it's one of the things that I put across to a lot of my cis women, you know, that they're kind of like, well, you know, you do a lot with the trans, what's that like, you know? And it's like, well, how do you feel when you look at in the mirror? Because they a lot of times they're like, I feel like a man. I was like, okay, now you get it. Now add extra things about your body that you have to deal with so you can be whole. And then they're like, oh, okay. They kind of get it a little bit, you know, it's, you know, when you look in a mirror and you got a face full of hair, especially if it's dark hair, you can really see, even if you shave, you can see the hair underneath the skin. I don't care if you're cis or trans, it could be horrendous.
Yes.
And I've got cis women, three hairs, they're crying in my chair because they think that they're a man. Those are valid feelings. That's real. I don't care if you got one hair or 10,000 hairs on your face. It affects, you know, it's a gender dysphoria, whether no matter how you're born, when you're getting a different reading from how you're presenting to who you are. And it can really affect people badly.
I mean, even though I've had mine removed so long ago, I still go to feel for it. Because I spent so many years looking for it so I could hide it or get rid of it or pluck it or shave it. So I'm still like expected to be there. And it's been like 5 years since I've had it removed. And I know how good it feels to have it gone. And so that's why I can't wait to do this for people. I'm like, you're going to love it. Because I felt so sexy and I felt so free. And it's been so much damn time. And I know I was bad. I didn't realize how bad it was to pluck. But maybe could you explain to people why it's so bad to pluck or wax?
Well, what it does is it distorts the hair follicle. The stimulation of the healing from that can also bring extra blood to the area, which when you have extra blood to the area and you're constantly doing it, you can trigger other hairs to come in darker. And also, if you're not plucking it very well and you're getting cocky with the angles and everything, you can distort the hairs. And hairs that are distorted, they're just harder to hit right spot on. And especially if you're doing thermolysis or doing a type of blend where you're using more thermolysis than you are galvanic current. But even with the blend, you got to get that probe right where it needs to be. And when that follicle is just doing crazy things, sometimes it's not that easy without really overtreating the skin. You know,
here's an example.
Balance.
Here's an example of what I think is a distorted follicle. And I'm just going to use my own example. And this is what I sometimes say to my clients. Of course, I spent years plucking my eyebrows. These are not mine. I had to have them tattooed on, right? So, but I spent years and years plucking, of course. The hair naturally grew, let's say, to the right, right? But when I'm plucking them this way, mm-hmm. not the way they grow. So now, when eyebrow hairs do grow in gray, they grow straight out. I'm pretty sure it's because it's the way I plucked them, pulling them out. And so now I've distorted the follicle and it's pointing this way instead of that way, like it's supposed to. They don't lay down anymore. They're just like,
I will also say with those white hairs, even men that don't do anything to their eyebrows, they will come in when their eyebrows start getting white, because when those eyebrows start turning white, they just decide to go wherever they want anyway.
They do.
And if you want to start talking about hair that's turning white in the eyebrow, I had a client yesterday that was in. It's like, oh, I have one white eyebrow hair. Can you zap it? I was like, well, that's right in the middle. And I can guarantee you, if I start zapping your white hairs, by the time you get older, you're not going to have any eyebrows left unless you want to get them microbladed or tattooed on, because you're going to get more. Yep. But it's so thick. It's like, that's what it is. You know, if you start zapping those now, you're going to lose all your eyebrows. So I show them how to trim it. And it's just like, hey, welcome to being able to, you know, continue living your life.
Because aging is a privilege. So
it's a privilege.
Yeah. Good thing to have. I have one client who is blonde, and she has a lot of blonde, but also silver gray hairs on her chin. And those things are juicy. They're thick. And almost like when I pull them out into a stack, they almost look like fish bones. Like that's how juicy and thick they are, and so satisfying. She's so happy that they're starting to be less and less now, you know. And she's like, oh my God, I never thought these would go away. I go, no, I got you. But man, those gray ones, why do they want to stay? They just want to stay. They don't want to leave.
The thick ones, well, it depends on what's going on hormonally, you know. And it's really making sure that you get in that good insertion and you get that, you know, current you need to. On top of it, if they've got a hormonal thing going on behind it, they still have the free-floating testosterone going around. And if that's not in control, that testosterone is going to be going somewhere. And they're like, oh, number 306 got killed. Let me go wake up 307.
Right.
Stop that. You know,
Kelly, why can't someone figure this out? Like, I always think of the face like when you're playing Battleship, right? And there's like A1, A2, A3, A4, A5, A6. I just want somebody to just go in and just real quick, tell this person, let me know what's here. And then I'll go in, I'll treat them. But like, can't someone figure it out? I mean, I know there's a million follicles on our body, but you would think by now we could figure out, because I want to know if I've treated a hair before. Did I do something incorrectly the first time? Was just in the wrong stage? I don't know. But I hate to treat the same damn hair three times or something like that. Like, I just don't want that to happen. You know?
Think of it this way. You know, I've had clients that go, I get the same hair every day and I pluck it and it comes back the next day. Nope. And it's like, well, do you pluck it? Do you get a root out? And they're like, yeah. And I'm like, either one or two things are happening. Either you're breaking the hair off and it's just growing. That's what I'm hoping for, because we truly don't have as many hairs. Or if you're truly getting a root out every time, that is one hair times seven times three in that one spot that you perceive to be one hair. And that's right. How many hairs are in that one spot. Now let's talk about the rest of your face.
Right.
You know, I forget which book it was where I got that. It can have between like 600 or 800 hairs on the face in a square centimeter. I think it was like 600 and something hairs. That's a lot of hairs, you know.
The thing the pandemic has done is, because of the masks, it's helping people to realize how many hairs they actually have on their face. Mm. Instead of them, oh, I have this one. I'm like, it's not just one, but I know everybody thinks that, you know, but I'm like, okay, if you think it's just one, how about just don't shave for 2 weeks. Let's see what happens. Like, okay. And then they're like, oh crap. I'm like, I told you it's not just one. So, but the mask, you know, cause you could go out with all kinds of hair on your face and no one knows, cause you're wearing a mask. So people are like, damn, Crystal, when can you get me in? Come on in.
The nice thing about that I was thinking that about the pandemic moving forward, especially electrologists, is, you know, that was the nice thing about, you know, winter time, you know, fall and winter. I'd tell people, hey, while it's cold, wear a scarf. Nobody can see you coming in with the plastic or their hair. You can kind of hide it. And moving forward, there are going to be people that you can just tell them, hey, just wear a mask, you know, and for the next, you know, few or several years, and who knows what society is going to be like. I mean, look at Asia. Anytime they're out in public, they wear masks. America may not be that tough, because, you know, nobody wants to talk. We don't like being told how or what to do, no matter what, you know, because it's all about me. And, it can give comfort for other people to say, you know what, I'm just going to wear a mask, or at least they can come in the office with a mask, like if they've got the plastic on and they're in the this zone. So at least we'll kind of get that little bit moving forward to help us in the future.
I kind of trip out on people that tell me, oh, I've been going to an electrologist for 45 years. I'm like, I hope that I don't see you for more than maybe a year or two, maybe two.
Well, I can tell you're somebody who's done 30 years. I started doing people when they were young and they were going through the puberty stuff, or they changed their hormone prescription for contraception and things went nuts. And
then they start working at other parts of their body too, right? But 45 years.
I'm talking just about the face. They get pregnant, and one pregnancy is different than the second pregnancy, different than the third pregnancy. And I've been doing long enough. Now I'm getting the women that I started with that now they're going through menopause. So I may not see them for a few years or like 10 years. And it's kind of like, you know, it's starting to become a joke now. If I hadn't seen somebody in like 10 or 15 years, it's like, oh, menopause now, right? And they're like, yeah.
That's very true, because I'm perimenopausal, and like I said, I had all my I had my very lush goatee, my neck beard, and some of my kitty whiskers removed. But I'm 52 now, so every once in a while, my brain's like, "Hey, let's grow a hair here." Even though she removed all my hair and it was been beautiful and great, but now my brain's like, "Hey, testosterone ready, bam, new hair, like right here." Especially, I'm getting a lot of these, and so I need to touch up.
Well, that's a nice thing with me. I just knock on the door next door. Hey, get this.
Me too.
Actually, because I didn't even get my first hair till I was 30. So I actually twiddled it for a week, because I was like, I want to play with it for a little while.
Cool. I know. I kind of
twiddled it for a little while, and then I'm like, okay, get her. You know, I actually did these, you know, in my, you know, late teens, early 20s. So I haven't shaved my pits in decades. You know, for a while I get a little cleanup at the convention or whatnot, because people want to try, you know, equipment and stuff like that. So,
In school I had them work on my right underarm, but we never got to my left one, but I'd really like to get them finished and get this one done, because it's so great to have less sweat, less odor.
Mm-hmm.
Beautiful. I love them. And then this is like, and it's like when you get eyebrows tattooed on, you don't have to think your eyebrows. That's also a big time saver. And so it's not having to shave your underarms. I see that in your title, and I know what it means, but maybe you could tell everybody what Kelly Morrissey CPE means.
Okay, well, CPE is Certified Professional Electrologist, and that's a certification you can get through the American Electrology Association. And it's a test that you have to take. Now I think it's done through a company called Prometrics, and they are all over the United States. They're a big testing warehouse for all sorts of types of testing. And a lot of people, I'm in a licensed state, and they're like, why be a CPE if you're in a licensed state? I was like, well, number one, the state didn't begin to get licensed until 2002. Mm-hmm. And I started in 1986, and I became a CPE in 1996. And my line of thought was, sooner or later, I got involved with the American Electrology Association because I felt like sooner or later, the state's going to get licensed. And I want to be involved with an association that at least will help me through this process, or at least let me know what's going on, so I'm not in my office in the dark and I don't know what's going on. Okay. And I was able to find out when we did get the licensing, was helped through on that. And so now we're a licensed state. And now I get people, and we encourage our students to become CPEs. And there's a couple different reasons. Number one, we don't know what we're going to do in our life. You may not live in a licensed state for your whole life. You may move somewhere else, go to another state, and now you're in an unlicensed state. You could say, I've been a CPE. I can do continuing education since 1996.
Yeah, that's pretty huge.
How involved and interested you are in your profession, which I think is a good thing. Also, as what I've learned, especially in the last several years, we almost lost our license three times. One was for Sundowners, and Sundowner is like once every 12 years, they go over, at least in Illinois, and I think it's in most of the states, but I can't answer for that. They go over licenses and decide, oh, we're going to keep this group licensed, and we're going to keep this group licensed. Oh, there's not enough of you, nobody cares, or we don't care, so we're just going to deregulate it. Well, we did get our Sundowners. The American Electrology Association was instrumental in helping us getting stuff together to present that to the state. So we were able to keep our license, our licenses. And we had a governor for the last 2 years of his term that was trying to deregulate stuff to make jobs. And all they're doing is looking at numbers because there's not a lot of licensed electrologists in Illinois. I mean, you're like, oh, we only have 1,000 whatever licensed electrologists. I wish we had that many licensed electrologists.
Yeah, yeah. Well, we have 40 million people though.
Yeah. Well, you know, still in a state where there's probably like 10,000 estheticians, there's like maybe less than 300 licensed electrologists. That's a problem.
Yeah.
You know? And so they don't care about us, you know, but we fought and we got that. So we almost lost our license a couple times over that. So if we ever do lose their license, I can say I've been a CPE since 1996. Nah, nah, you know, it's a little bit of marketing too, you know, and,
for sure. Oh, yeah,
you know, and all that stuff, that all that stuff matters, you know?
Yeah. I mean, to me, you always want to be working with people who care about continued education. And I've talked to lots of people that, you know, are like beauticians and other electrologists and stuff. And they're like, they don't really even know, like there's a AEA. Like they've been working on their own for all these years and they felt like a little island all unto themselves. I want to learn what's new in the, you know, sanitation, sterilization. I want to learn about the new vendors. I want to learn about new machines, and I want to learn new techniques, and I want to learn new ways. I just want to learn everything I can. I don't want to just be like, okay, I'm good. I learned everything. I'm just going to keep working on hair. I want to learn what's better and what's the best new technique or the best new practice. You know, like I always want to work with people that are like that. I don't want to work with somebody who's just like kind of resting on their laurels. You know, that's not a good way to live as a human in general. Like I want my brain to stay young, you know?
And that's one of the nice things is nice about continuing education, especially national, you know, it's like for a long time, I not only went to national pretty much every year, except for when I just couldn't or, you know, whatnot. I would also go to the local stuff. I mean, I could like, if I could like sell my CPE credits, like under the table, like I'd be making bank, you know, but,
right. Yeah.
But you know, you can't, you know, but,
how do people start being the CEUs? They start going to events and stuff.
Huh?
How do we get our CEUs?
There's the national event, you know, and you know, they usually have like vendors there. Like they always have Ducto and Institutron and Clairblend is always there. Silhouette Tone is there sometimes. Sterix is there, and you can go play with toys. I mean, sometimes that's one of the reasons why I like having extra CEUs. So if there is a seminar on how to shape an eyebrow, I can do it in sleep. You know, I'm going to go play in the vendor room, you know, with a colleague that maybe wants to learn a trick or watch another colleague or just play around with stuff with toys in the vendor room because, you know, I'm that weirdo, you know. So it's one of the things that I like about actually going to national and stuff like that. Also through the AEA, there's a list of continuing education that you can do. If you're a member of AEA, you get two booklets a year that they call JOES, a Journal of Education, that you get 0.3 CEUs twice a year. So, you know, as a member, you get 6 hours sent to you and you can actually do it online. There's a link that you can fill it out and then answer it online and get the results right away instead of having to mail it in. So they really try to do it to make it easy to get stuff and get hooked up. And the other nice thing about this pandemic is it's really opening the door to virtual learning. We did our last two seminars, you know, via GoToMeeting, you know. So I think that's going to be the wave of the affiliates. And I think the AEA, maybe actually we're talking about that because I'm the president of EAI, which is the Illinois chapter. And we're actually going to, it's one of the things the board and I were going to be discussing via internet, you know, on how we're going to need to, we need to change things. We need to move it forward because
time to pivot.
We got to get it to where it's easier access because not everybody can travel now.
Right. So, no.
Yeah. We're figuring it out.
Let's hope for we can have an in-person conference next year, but our last conference for our chapter here was like 2 days before the quarantine. We got shut down, but people were being careful that day because they were like, we knew it was possibly coming. And I think we were even wearing, most of us were wearing masks, but you're getting ready to teach a class, aren't you?
Actually, we just got, in October the 18th, I'm going to be doing a virtual class for MAPE. And I'm going to be talking about, I got a 2-hour lecture on consultations. I'm doing an hour lecture on probes and modalities and an hour lecture on surgery prep for trans folks. So it's going to be 4 hours. And I think they're going to get a 5th hour in there, or they're going to try to. I know they got 4 because I'm doing them. But, you know, I think they're going to try to get a 5th hour in there so people can get 5 CEUs.
Can anybody sign up for those, or does it have to be part of?
Anybody can sign up. I mean, I think I sent you the link.
Yeah,
so if you put that up, anybody can sign up for that. And it's different pricing depending on whether you're a MAPE member or whether you're an AEA member. And if you're a non-member, you have to pay more. If you need the continuing education, anybody can get it.
So one last question before we go. When you're quoting your trans clients, I mean, I know this is hard to answer, but I'm trying to tell my clients, you know, if you're pre-surgery, we need a good 2 years. Mm-hmm. Is that about what you say?
Yeah. I tell people in a perfect world, I like 18 months to 2 years.
Yeah.
I want at least a year. Anything else than that, I will do the best I can with the time you've got.
Yeah.
And at least you will have less than you would have had you not done anything at all.
Right. Yeah.
And I had one that just started the other day. There are surgeries in October. So it's like, you know, they're looking at October, maybe November. You know, it's like, I can't guarantee anything, but they did have some laser before, but, you know, we're not sure how effective that is because they had a laser treatment 3 weeks ago, you know? So I just went in on everything I could and, you know, we'll just kill what comes up between now and 3 weeks before the surgery.
I wish we could somehow get the word out to the doctors that are giving this information out. Like, we need more time. How do we get them to know we need more time?
Well, the problem with the doctors is people aren't seeing the doctors until they're ready for surgery, and that's already getting to be too late. You know, it's like, oh, I went to the doctor, I got surgery in 6 months, and I found out they needed this electrolysis. You know, it needs to be to the point to where the psychologists, when people are coming in with this, or widely known, you know, a lot of times when I'm giving consultations to trans folks, I'm like, tell your friends, tell all your friends, make it really known. You know, this process takes time.
Get the word out in the community somehow, if we can, because yeah, I can tell if they get let down, you know, when I tell them, they're like, I'll do my best, but you know, it's a long process. And, you know, obviously this stuff can take more time, but if they're having surgery, that's where it's really important. And anyway, it's tricky. I know it's still tricky out there, but yeah, I felt that's one thing that broke my heart during the pandemic was that my clients who had to put their surgeries off at least another, you know, good 6 months or more. And I was like, and they're begging me, please. I'm like, I just can't.
Yeah.
My license at risk. I put my establishment person's license at risk. I just can't. I want to, but I can't because it's too risky. And if something happened, my insurance, I'm sure, wouldn't cover it. You know, there's a million reasons. And I felt heartbroken for them because I know how much they're looking forward to this, you know, and it's like, I'm so sorry.
Well,
and COVID.
Every state's a little bit different. Now, when we originally shut down, I actually talked to the attorney of the Village of Oak Park here, because I forget the name of which government branch that oversees stuff, that put out the statement that, you know, if it's medically necessary, you know, you can do the service. And, you know, I called the attorney and said, it's like, look, I get people ready for these surgeries and it takes time to do this. It's not like I do it once and they go. It takes, you know, explain the process a little to them. And the attorney said, you know, I've been telling people no all day long. It's like, you understand the risks. I'm going to leave it up to you. If you want to go ahead and work on these people as long, and that was the thing, if they have written doctor's letter saying that, you know, what you provide is medically necessary in preparation, I'm okay with you doing that. And so, but I was like kind of in the middle, not sure what. I've got two older people that live at home, with me, you know, my dad and my aunt. So, I was like, I'm not going to push it. You know, I only had like two clients that were supposed to be getting surgery and they were pretty much as good as they're going to get. You know, one less treatment really wasn't going to put them over the big mark. And so during that time, I decided not to do it. However, this time, what I'm doing is I'm telling my clients, and I'm telling this to my cis women too, because I think it's important that insurance starts acknowledging cis women with this problem. And what I'm saying is, first find out if your insurance covers treatment for trans folks, and then demand you need this too, because this is mentally affecting you, just like, you know, especially the facial hair. Women need to start voicing how it's just as damning, especially if they already are covering it for trans people. And get me a doctor's note. So yep. I'm telling
you, if you
get shut down again, you bring me a doctor's note, I will work on you. But, and I told my staff, I go, this is personally what I'm doing. You guys decide what it is you want to do, because it's each an individual license on what they feel like. And I'm going to respect whatever choices people make, but I'm kind of getting older. I don't give a shit. So I'm a little bit of a rebel, you know? So I'm like, you bring me a doctor's note, I'm zapping you.
You know,
that's part of how things go in this state. I can't speak for every other state because I don't know how the rules are in every other state, but that's personally what I'm going to be doing if we kind of get shut down again.
Yeah, we got the approval to work with a doctor's note about a week before the other approval. So, yeah, but I hear you. And I think it's a good point to make that we need to keep making noise around that going forward, because when this happens again, or we get called back in or whatever, we need to say, you know, get your doctor's note, and at least then we're covered. And, you know, if you feel comfortable doing it, I mean, if you're wearing your mask and your shield and they're wearing their mask, you know, I mean, whatever it is that you do to make yourself feel safe. But I think you're right. It's a very personal decision. You have, everybody has to make the decision on their own and your life and maybe the people around you. Like, my biggest fear is I would never want to get anybody else sick. So, I mean, of course I don't want to get sick, but I also would never want to pass along to anybody else, which is why I'm being so freaking safe, because it's just not worth it. It's just hair. I mean, I know it sucks, but it's just hair. It's not like we're removing tumors, you know, we're not doing brain surgery yet.
But just, quite frankly, emotionally,
it is very emotional.
It might as well be a tumor.
It might
for some of these folks, you know,
and you're right.
Like cis and trans women, if they have it really bad, like, I mean, there was like about three clients I was very, very concerned about during this time, because it was so dysphoric for them. Mm-hmm. And one ended up in the hospital she ended up, she couldn't see her, she ran out of meds. Mm-hmm. Couldn't see a psychiatrist. She's off her meds. And she just got to that dark place. And at least I was like, you know, you need to do something, you know, and she checked herself in.
Good. Good.
So, you know,
it's very scary. And there's one of my clients I was worried about too. And cause I would see her twice a week, right cheek, left cheek, right cheek, left cheek, you know? And I was like, oh, I hope she gets through this, but the mask helped her a lot. And, anyway, yeah, it's a lot. I almost feel like electrolysis could be considered essential, you know, especially people have like the trans hair issues or like PCOS or other things that make them have a lot of hair. Cause you're right. It's hard to walk around in life like that. That's not easy for anybody. And it's too bad that we couldn't keep working on them, because also all the progress we had made, you know, I'm like, oh man, just getting going, you know, like, when they're new.
You get on the roll and they snap right back in.
I know. And they're all like, why can I come in? So anyway, great talking with you, Kelly. I really appreciate all of your time and all of your knowledge and all your expertise. And thank you for everything that you do for our community and our industry. I'm just learning. There's so much to learn, but I know that you have a lot to share and I know you're willing to share your information. I really appreciate that.
Oh, you're welcome. Anytime. Just like I said, make your list.
Okay. Yeah, we'll do this again. All right. Take care. Thank you so much.
You're welcome. Bye-bye.